Our presenter, Dr. Stephen Hall, is the Director of Employment Policy and Research at Griffin-Hammis Associates. Stephen has a Ph.D. in Disability Policy and Adult Education from the Rehabilitation Research and Training Center on Supported Employment and Workplace Supports at Virginia Commonwealth University. Stephen has strong relationships with state and federal government leaders, universities, and provider and advocacy organizations. He is a former commissioner of behavioral health, state director of developmental disabilities, and CEO of two community provider organizations. Dr. Hall was a subject matter expert with the Office of Disability and Employment Policy. He was a member of the National Association of Developmental Disabilities Directors, president-elect, and chair of the research committee for 7 years. And I'd just like to welcome Stephen this morning or this afternoon, wherever you're calling in from, and I will turn it over to you, Steve. Thank you.
Great. Thanks so much, Pam. I mean, all you need to, and thanks to Easterseals of Southern California for, often most of my work in California is at their request, and so I'm very happy to be doing this. So let me go back to that. So I just want to say from everything that Pam said, all you need to know really about me is that obviously the guy couldn't keep a job. So hopefully this will, these slides keep jumping. So hopefully this will maybe show you either why that was the case, or it'll show you that, okay, well, maybe this, he knows a little bit about this. Customized employment. There may be some people on here who don't know what customized employment is. Let me just take a few minutes to say what it is. And then, and because maybe many of you do know what customized employment is, I don't want to bore you with those, long overview of that. So this customized employment is, it's in the Rehabilitation Act. It's in WIOA, the Workforce Employment Act, Opportunity Act. And what it's about is a very, very much more individualized approach to getting citizens who are eligible for support employment. Usually that's the group. People have significant disabilities for them to get jobs. So that's the group that it provides services for. The unique features of it is something called discovery that happens at the beginning. So it's an alternative to evaluations or assessments. You can't fail discovery, whereas obviously evaluations by nature, you can fail those. You can fail different parts of an evaluation, different parts of an assessment. Doesn't do any of that. Instead, it's discovery, no evaluation, no assessments are involved in customized employment. Discovery replaces those. It's followed by customized job development, which is very different than traditional job development. The traditional job development, oftentimes the work is a caseload of 20 or 30 or maybe sometimes more people that you need to get jobs for, and you go about developing relationships with businesses, because when somebody's referred, you got to be sure you have that relationship with business set up to likely place a person in a job where there may be a job opening and some place that has some history of being friendly to hiring people with disabilities. That's not this at all. That's not customized employment. Customized employment instead says you're going to go out there and you're only going to go to the very businesses that for your job development, only those businesses that have the same interests, same work that they do, that the person who has that what's called a vocational theme or what their interests are in employment. So very different. And even who is contacted about a job. So it isn't about getting people jobs. It's always about getting people in the ideal conditions of employment. And then when the job happens, then another big change in customized employment is it's not the job coach model. A job coach is not the person's primarily responsible for the training and teaching. Instead, the person's primarily responsible for training and teaching is a coworker. And so what the job coach becomes is a consultative, has a much more of a consultative or a completely a consultative role. And again, tons of details and all of that. I'll hit on some of those maybe today and some as I'm talking about something else. But I'll go through a little bit of those. But so this presentation is not about, is not an overview of customized employment. What this presentation is fidelity to best practices. In other words, this idea of fidelity, it's the idea of doing things not because it sounds right, feels right, because somebody really smart wrote a book about it, because somebody you heard a great presentation or multiple presentations it need to do it, not because the state says, yeah, we're going this way, let's fund this, this sounds like a good thing, not be for any of those reasons. Fidelity says data, you got real information, you have real proof that, oh, this is what to do, not just that, well, this makes sense, well, this is a lot better thing. It's not that way of thinking at all. This is fidelity to best practices saying, we think we know what might be the very best practice of this because we have some proof that it's the very best practices. And that's why we're going about doing this, because it's more likely that the outcome is going to be a good job, good wages, and a job that lasts. So that's what fidelity to best practices means in customized employment. So let's go. All right, so fidelity thinking, just talk about this how to think with fidelity, is that you want to seek information before forming an opinion or taking an action. In other words, you're trying to get information. You're making sure there's some reliable and valid evidence. Folks, in the last 7 years, four Nobel Prizes now have been awarded, including one just 3 weeks ago, for what I've just said. In other words, Nobel Prizes were awarded in behavioral economics. One of the Nobel Prize winners wrote a book, and the title of the book was Thinking Fast and Slow. And the whole purpose of behavioral economics is finding that human beings, and one of the books was titled Misbehavior. And so the whole purpose of this is to say that human beings tend to think fast, tend to have their minds already made up about most things, tend to go with what they've known before, and I'll go through some of these, and tend to think about things and make decisions on things based on experience and not on real data, information, valid evidence about it. In other words, we think fast. I got that figured out. I had that figured out years ago. I'm done. I'm good. Yeah, we got this. We know what to do. In other words, it's people that human beings, most human beings already have their mind made up. So when new data comes in, then they don't see it. They ignore it. They don't know what to, well, I don't understand this. This don't sound like anything I've done. No, never mind. Set it aside. Don't read it. Don't research it. Don't that. So what this is saying, fidelity thinking is certainly being curious, certainly being open-minded. And it's saying that we need to have, valid evidence before we go about, thinking. I'll talk some more about this in the future, but know that fidelity thinking is an uncommon way to go about the world saying, yeah, I know most people think that's the case. I know most people think that whether it's a fence around, you say you're putting a fence in your yard. Well, this is what most people buy. So I guess I should buy that. Well, wait a minute. No, just why is there different fencing materials for a yard? Just anything that may come up. Why are we doing that? And it's about saying, let's slow down and don't just go what most people said. Don't just go with what, a neighbor, a friend, somebody that you even trust says, let's find other valid evidence. Okay. All right. An example of non-fidelity thinking. Someone believes a new course of action will achieve a better outcome than past practices. Okay. So somebody says, well, I think, like I speak, I think that customized employment will bring about better results than supported employment. Now, I happen to believe that because of data evidence for that. I had lots of questions about customized employment. Remember, I was trained at the National Rehabilitation Research and Training Center on workplace support. Got a doctor's degree there. I trained people who were getting master's degrees in supported employment. So believe me, I'm embedded all the way with support employment. So for me to say what I'm about to say is really something different. And I can say to this to you this clear as I can say it to anything. I guarantee you that customized employment is absolutely superior method to get most anybody. I mean, I'm going way beyond just people that it's already sanctified for in the Rehab Act. I'm saying that it is a great way for people who have significant challenges of any kind to becoming employed. And so, for example, you should see the data, right? That's Fidelity thinking. The data on 50-year-old white men, 50-year-old white men who have had a career, a job or whatever, that 50-year-old white men that are high school or less, or have high school education or less, if they lose their job at age 50, you should see the data on what chance they would have to ever become employed again. And the answer is zero. You should see it. I mean, it's like, oh my God, you're kidding me. If you're over 50 and you're white, I mean, remember, we're living in a society that's pretty white dominated, right? You know, so with that said, if those folks are having some difficulty, what might that mean for the rest of us? Really, the data. Or when on customized employment, when I ask my coworkers and I ask other people across the nation, and you know, I've in some capacity, I've done some work or had some influence or in about 43, not about, in 43 states. So when I ask folks, hey, customized employment, so tell me how many black women you've gotten jobs through customized employment. All I hear are crickets. Nobody says, don't hear silence, because the data's not there. So, the data shows, whoops, we might have a real problem, racism, whatever it may be. We have a real problem in a new innovation in employment that has some real promise. Is it, who is this for? Who's it getting to? So there's an example of Fidelity thinking. It's like, let's make sure that when we're doing something that everybody gets a shot at it, not just those people who speak English as their primary language, making sure that it's for everyone. So non-Fidelity thinking, you respected whatever new ideas, I'm reading the bottom line there, in the past, so it's only logical to follow something new that somebody comes out with. So what they did before was good. This might be good. But here's an example of Fidelity thinking. Here, somebody says new course of action will be better than the past practices, just like I'm saying to you. You respect these new ideas in the past, but it's only logical to research something new thoroughly before forming an opinion. So when I'm saying, well, okay, I hear what you're saying. You think customized employment is better than supported employment, or maybe better than many things that vocational rehabilitation and mental health and intellectual service to people with intellectual disabilities, or maybe a whole bunch of money that's been spent, maybe billions of dollars have been spent in other ways. Let's look at what the evidence is to that. So that's Fidelity. Okay. So let's look at what the data says. Let's give an example. Okay. The assumption the assumption based on the RSA. So what is customized employment? Let's look at the RSA regulation on customized employment. What does the RSA regulation say? It says persons eligible for supported employment are eligible for customized employment. People often don't know that. They think, well, support employment is one thing, customized employment is another thing. So, I mean, there must be some people that's eligible for customized employment and other people is eligible for support employment. Not the case. Again, here's the very act that says it's for that. You know, it's like job development. People always think, well, with job development, it's just for people, I won't get into that too deep. Let me just go on. I won't get into job development. I'll cover that later. Okay, let's go on with assumption number two. Assumption based on a common understanding. The common understanding of customized employment is it is for persons with more significant needs than persons with support employment. That's just what most people think. Most people think that. Find that in some regulation. Find that somewhere that, oh, that's who these folks are for. Well, no, I had people tell me that. Well, we had somebody that talked about that and said, that's who this is for. You know, where's the evidence? It's not there, because the evidence is saying clearly it's for people that are eligible for support employment, people that have significant disabilities, whether in mental health needs, intellectual disabilities, or others. So, oh, well, then even the group is different. But let's look at some more. Now let's look at the data. This is the data that I've collected across 10 states, across about, now we're close to 170 people that I have had the pleasure of training and teaching how to be Discovery Fidelity Scale or Job Development Fidelity Scale administrators, something that I'll talk maybe a little bit later about. But how something called Discovery, there's something called a Discovery Fidelity Scale. It's something called a Job Development Fidelity Scale. Not now, but sometime later, if you want to go to the Griffin-Hammis website, you can go there, you can pull down your own copy of that. You can't use it, you shouldn't use it without training and teaching to know how to use it right, to use it well at all. But if you want to look at it yourself, go look at the Job Development Fidelity Scale, go look at the Discovery Fidelity Scale there. So what does the data, here's what the data says, is that people who are eligible for customized employment, the people who are actually getting customized employment, are younger. In fact, in our data, we've only found one person over 40 years old. Well, right off the bat, you got an age discrimination problem, right? Right off the bat, why in the world did anybody, who told who that you should only serve people if they're in their 20s and 30s in, or sometimes in school age, sometimes 18, 19, who said that's who customized employment is for? Nobody said that, but what the data is showing is that that for some reason, nobody is being referred who is over 39 years old. Ah, so what is it? Well, what's going on? Okay, let's look at a little more in the data. It's people without another identified funding source. So in other words, if a person is already on a waiver resource, far less likely they're going to be referred for customized employment. In other words, who's getting referred for customized employment is somebody that don't already have a gig going, some kind of funding thing, they're in some type of service, something else going on. So this is about with somebody without, any other funding source. People say, well, we see our waiver services are all full, we always have all those full. Hey, we got this customized employment, maybe we should try that. In other words, it's not being no logic or rationale for why that referral is being made. That's what the data is showing. Not living in a group home. It's showing if you're in customized employment. Now, remember, this is not nobody, but this is like it's a very extremely low percentage compared to everybody else. If you're living in a group home, it is rare that you're going to be referred for customized employment, because customized employment is a hassle. I mean, come on. Customized employment is going to find people, you know, ideal conditions of employment. And some of those may be in the evenings, weekends, other times that the group home is like, oh, wait a minute. In the evenings, we got you. We need somebody out of this group home during the day. You know, in fact, going to a day center is great, but if you're going to work, please work in the daytime. That's most convenient to us. Customized employment can really mess that kind of thing up, because it's looking for ideal conditions of employment. So if somebody like Raymond, who we got a job, whose whole family works at night. I mean, Raymond had no idea about what this day work even is. You know, he got a job in a nightclub. A comedy club. Then it was like, yeah, of course, because that's when he thought people work. Customized employment, somebody like that, never make a referral. And then it's overwhelmingly white and it's overwhelmingly male. Whoa, who said that we're going to have extraordinary discrimination in customized employment? Again, if you don't look at the data at the intersection of disability and race, then, well, it pops up. So people say, well, what are you saying? If the system is racism? No, I'm saying that it looks like that race is playing a part of this. And it looks like it only being offered or primarily being offered to people not being offered to women, and as far nearly as much as support, employment, and other things are being offered to women, and certainly not being offered to people who are not white. So that's what the data is showing across the country. Okay, so so this is what Fidelity Thinking says. It says, let's start out from the get-go knowing if we're going to do customized employment, we got to be sure that our acts together so that when we keep getting referrals for young white men to get jobs who don't have another funding source and don't live in a group home, that we're asking the question, tell me why there is not, we're not serving folks that are in group home, people that don't meet that demographic. So that's again, Fidelity Thinking. You can see it's about curiosity. It's starting to question, it's starting to ask, it's starting to notice who's missing when we're doing great things for folks. Okay, basic tools. Two basic tool ideas. Evidence that the idea delivers most of the time. Again, everybody can have one-shot ideas, one great idea. Oh, this happened. Oh, isn't that great? You know, oh, this is super. Yeah, look, I know a guy who did. Yeah, we all got that. We all got the story. We all got somebody. But what this is saying, it's not just give me an example. Give me an example. Sure, we can always pull great, great examples of different things that happened really great. But this means, is there evidence that it happens most of the time with people? In other words, does customized employment just work once in a while, or does it work consistently? Is there evidence that the idea is sustainable over time? In other words, is the funding of it, is it locked in? Does it mean that if a provider agency says, okay, all right, we've had some training, we've talked with some people, we're all in. How about sustainability? I need, if you will, referrals of a provider. First thing a employment provider is going to say is, you give me steady referrals, because if you expect me to invest in personnel in customized employment, then I'll make that investment. But I can't have them just sitting there twiddling their thumbs. I need to set steady, steady referrals coming from VR or the IDD agency, state agency, whoever, regional center, wherever it is. I need steady, steady referrals, or I can't make an investment. So that idea is just one of the ideas of why things need to be sustainable. And circumstances that might get in the way. So the people implementing an idea are not ideal. So again, I got data across the country, and if you're trying to pay people, you know, $13 an hour, 14, 15, 16 bucks an hour. You're trying to pay people, right at or under $30,000 a year to do this kind of work. It's like they're going to go get another better job. You're investing in folks that aren't likely. So you got to have the money's got to be, money can't be funny. It's got to be right. You have to be a solid investment in people doing this work. Can't be that, oh, I'll just take whatever job that pays 5,000 bucks more. It has to be so that this job is treated like the professional job it is. It's a job in customized employment means you are likely out there in the public as the sole representative of that organization to the entire business community and entire community, period. That's got to be right. That's the financing is sketchy. It's like, well, we get the funding this way and that way, that kind of stuff. The money isn't right. That's how you get that chief fiscal officer telling that CEO, hey, I know you love customized employment. I know you love community integrated employment. I know you love all that stuff. I know I see it in a newsletter all the time, but here's the data. The data is showing that we're not being reimbursed well enough for what's going on, and maybe the productivity isn't right or whatever's not right, but I'm going to have to report this to the board of directors as part of the fiscal report showing that part of our service and support is a loss leader. And after a while, some of the board of directors may say, maybe we ought to go do something else. So financing has to be right. And the beneficiary can be blamed for its failure. And this has been the problem with lots of things that we do and service and supports to people with the most challenging behaviors, is at the end of the day, if it doesn't work, well, hey, what happened is mom did this. His dad did that. They said they would do this, and then they didn't do this. He said he liked such and such. It turns out he didn't. He did this. It didn't work out. Oh, he couldn't do, you know, again, somewhere the beneficiary is blamed. In other words, we already know this. If you know everything about what you're doing, then we know that after 18 months, then about 28% of the folks are likely not going to have their job. But it does mean that close to 3/4 of people are going to have their job. And also we have data that shows the second time through, the success of people are nearly 80%. So just know that with all that said, no, we're not expecting this to be some perfect where everybody always works out great. But again, looking at evidence and data, hey, guess what? Almost 3/4 of the time, this is dynamite. This really works. So that's again, looking at data when you think about this and not using, oh, the person can be blamed for it. Okay. So Pam, do we have questions? Any questions written in the?
Not at this time, but if anyone would like to type anything in the chat box, feel free.
Okay.
Nothing yet, Steve. Nothing yet.
Okay, keep going.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll stop again a little bit later. So anything I've said, like if slide previously or whatever, then don't hesitate to ask. So other circumstances, not enough time is allotted. You know, it's like, well, how they fund this, they just give us 6 weeks to get discovery done or get some portion done. Others involved are less cooperative. Well, the group home, hey, they won't cooperate. They won't get the person there on time. They won't do what they're supposed to do. The parents, they said they liked it. They said they were fine with this. But as it turned out, they never followed through. And after a while, he lost his job because, you know, he got fired because he wouldn't come to work on time. In other words, all kinds of things that could interfere. Financial disincentives discourage the outcome. Well, it turns out that the rate that the state is paying for day services, you know, it turns out that it's like, you know, $5, $6, or $7 a quarter hour. Well, that all sounds like, well, that well, we're paying, so this, I'm making up numbers. We don't know what numbers are. But let's say we're paying $60, $65 an hour for customized employment. And then over here in the day services, they're paying the equivalent of $20 an hour for a day services. Well, it's like, well, sure. Well, then customized employment must be better. Oh, wait a minute. Over there in the day services, they allow you to put people in groups of 10 or 20. So suddenly what looks like a $20 an hour is suddenly, you know, a $200 or $400 an hour proposition. So now all of a sudden a nice rate of, you know, $60+ an hour is having to compete with another service that is paying the provider, you know, over $200 an hour. You figure out who might win on that one. You know, it's like when you have powerful disincentives to community integrated employment by hugely overpaying for, congregated or segregated services of grouping of people, then you can see that everybody's going to be not everybody, but people that benefit and gain from that working out that way, which obviously is not people with disabilities, are going to do whatever. They're going to be heavily biased to go that way. Okay. And just other incentives for employment, are missing. That is in, you know, some states do different. I'll just say that there's different things that happen in different states around employment that make it easier for things to work. For example, the rate understands that when you hire a new employee to do community integrated employment of any kind, that the productivity of that personnel is not so hot. It's not that good in the first 2 months. If you're hiring somebody to work in a day center or a group home on behalf of somebody with a disability, then the moment they hit the door, it's billable, 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 billable every second. But when you are doing something like community integrated employment, when you hit the door, well, there's a learning period of a couple months where the productivity is way down because they're learning how to do whatever it is. Because every good job, just like in customized employment, a person does not know how to do the job before they got it. All of you there that have good jobs, you didn't know how to do those jobs before you got the job. You had somebody that believed in you, and had a great, hopefully that was your boss and other coworkers that helped you learn how to do that job, and you likely helped others that came along after you. That's how good jobs work for people with disabilities, how good jobs work for all of us. Okay. All right. You got to have a strategy. If you're going to implement something like customized employment, you got to think of a strategy. What are you going to do about people who don't have an interest in success? In other words, or maybe people have an interest. It's a nice way of saying that maybe people have an interest in it failing. That is, that, you know, why nobody, who would be that? Oh yes. Remember, a lot of times people just think there's just one pot of money and here's all it can be spent. So not everybody, because you have a good idea, doesn't mean everybody's like, oh, it's a good idea, then everybody's for it. No, that is oftentimes the case. So there are people who don't have interest in something succeeding. There's some people that want to be that want to keep doing what they're doing and stay comfortable. And there's people that already are busy. You have a full day of work already. I'd like to help you out. I'd like to be a part. I'd like to do whatever. But I've already got a full day of work going on, and I really don't have time for this in my life, you know? And so sometimes that's a VR counselor. It's already overloaded with cases, already has plenty going on. The last thing they may think they need is somebody coming in the door saying, hey, we have a great idea about how to do this psychosocial habilitation and rehabilitation intervention. Nobody talks like that, but that's what it is. Called customized employment. That's a lot better. Can we talk to you about it? And they're thinking, are you kidding me? I'm barely able to keep up with what we're doing now. We don't need something new on top of this. Well, wait a minute. I have data to show it's better. You see, know that you have to have a strategy to address these issues to ensure that people have fair access to something that's really good. Okay. I wrote a paper for the U.S. Department of Labor that they paid me too much money for. And they said, Steve, this is a really great paper. And this is really good. And we really like it. And yeah, boy, you know, here's your check. You know, thanks, you know. But we're not publishing it. No. We're not going to publish this, because it'll be too controversial. So that controversy, you get to hear about the paper right here. And what the paper said was simply this, that in the transition, we had the entire United States in wagons and buggies in 1905. Okay, we're in 1905, wagons, buggies. That's what we had. That's what everybody's getting around, wagons, buggies. Almost all, obviously, horse-drawn carriages of various fire. That's what it was. And then by 1915, 10 years now, complete transformation of the entire transportation system of the United States. 10 years, just 10 years, boom, changed. The only wagon or carriage manufacturer that succeeded in that transition was the Studebaker Corporation out of South Bend, Indiana. That's the only people that were making lots and lots of carriages, lots and lots of wagons, and went right into the automobile industry and succeeded beyond anybody's wildest dreams and stayed in business. I think they went out of business finally in the 1970s, I think sometime. It was the last Studebakers made. So Avanti was one of their cool cars they made, everybody liked. Okay, so what the paper was about is we go about this work, assuming we assume every provider that provides services to people with disabilities is the Studebaker Corporation. We assume that we have Studebakers, if you will, all the way down, all the way. In other words, we assume that everybody's going to make this transition. But think about the automobile and wagon manufacturer, and think about it, talking about the entire United States, only one made that transition. Everybody else was a new entrepreneur startup company, the Dodge brothers, two brothers that got together. Okay, we'll make this. Okay. Walter Chrysler idea, Louis Chevrolet and Gaston Chevrolet. You know, these were two brothers that decided, okay, let's get together and have this car called Chevrolet. You know, obviously Henry Ford, you know, on and on and on. So what you had was people that were not involved at all in wagons and that. So the challenge is in our field is, what are we doing to really, really incentivize and reward people who want to do this sort of thing for a living? Or are we thinking everybody's Studebaker and all what we're going to do is spend our whole life trying to get people that are heavily invested financially and in their whole way of thinking about having people in services together using the same building and then people with disabilities there. Disability services history, you know what it is, you know, institutions, then community, and then now with the Medicaid final rule, then we're saying people need to be in some places besides congregated, segregated, isolated with each other. But here's the money, folks. Check this out. Last year in the United States, in Medicaid funding for people with intellectual disabilities, $64 billion was spent. $64 billion. Only 1.8%, not even 2%, 1.8% was spent on community integrated employment out of that $64 billion. In other words, not even $1 billion of $64 billion was spent on employment, community integrated employment, the thing that you might be interested in if you're on this webinar. So we have a real issue of where the money, like I had a great boss one time. I was a new commissioner in my first 4 hours. The head of the cabinet who worked directly with the governor said to me, remember this, commissioner, it's not about the money unless it's about the money. And it's always about the money. So that's what this is getting at. What are we doing to make sure that we don't just keep, well, just keep everybody whole? Well, maybe that's not how we ended up transitioning that entire industry there to that. So entire automobile industry into the future. We made sure that we did what we needed to do with public policy, building roads and bridges like wild to be able for these new self-powered vehicles to be able to transverse a much better road than had ever been put down. So that's some of the things that happened. Vocational rehabilitation history, you know that, you know, 1920, folks coming home from the war, helped them out. So in 1943, some changes to that. You know, 1980 was support employment, and then now with WIOA, we got customized employment. So just quick history, there's vocational rehabilitation. Big, big thing about vocational rehabilitation, it's only interested in employment. It's focused, it's absolutely focused in employment. And vocational rehabilitation, when European scholars did an analysis of the best law that was ever written in the history of the planet, is vocational rehabilitation, because vocational rehabilitation serves those folks that have the most significant disabilities. So in other words, when given limited resources, all other laws say, well, let's do the best we can with for the most number of people, given the money we got. Everybody thinks that's right. But that 73 Rehabilitation Act said, nope, given limited dollars. And we don't just do the best we can and serve the most number. What we do, we drive those dollars down to people who had the most significant disabilities. That is the people who without this service would not be able to participate in this democracy at all. So that is a very different act. It's a very different way to look at things. It's making sure that we get people who have the most significant challenges in jobs. Community integrated employment history. The big part of the history, of course, was in the 1980s, led by Secretary Madeline Will, when we began something called supported employment, that really said that everybody can work in the community. There's no reject policy, no discrimination policy, and then evolved today to customized employment. Okay. All right. I'm going to go through some of these fairly quickly, but so this idea of thinking differently, in other words, what I'm saying to you is that it'd be a good idea that you thought differently, and it will help you come up with better, more creative ways of helping people getting that have significant challenges in employment, getting jobs, but you got to know what your own biases are and do what you can to remove them. Now, there's different books you can get on behavioral economics. There's all kinds of, things like that. So I'm going to just go through some of the things that are in every textbook on behavioral economics. And remember, the last 7 years, 4 Nobel Prizes in economics on exactly what you got on the screen right now. I mean, that's not a minor detail. It's saying that our brains are wired up, and what we're doing with them is misbehavior, that we're not making the best decisions with what we got. Again, worldwide, physicians, everybody in any field, it don't matter how educated you are, beliefs about anything, we got some issues. Here's some of them. We have an aversion to trying anything new because we're afraid that it's going to be a risk or removed. For example, you ask a family, hey, you want to try a community integrated employment? We got this new thing called customized employment. What do you think? Will they lose their Social Security? Oh, no, they won't lose their Social Security. No, we'll write a pass plan. We'll do such and such like that. And by the way, if they get a really good job, yeah, then there may be some lost in some Social Security dollars, but it's more than made up by how much money that we made with it when they're working. So what you're saying is that they will lose part of their Social Security check, the amount of the Social Security check, if they go to work and this is real successful. Well, yeah, I wouldn't say it that way. I know you wouldn't say it that way, but guess what? No, thank you. I don't want to do anything that's going to interfere with that. Oh, okay, then we're going to get people jobs, 10 hours, 12 hours, 16 hours a day, and the rest of the time they're in segregation with other people and day services. In other words, we're going to do employment as a token. You see the issue? The issue is whenever there's a loss, of any kind, even if it makes so much more sense, take a little loss, look at the gain. What behavioral economics is saying, people will say no. In Europe, 30 nations are doing exactly what we're doing. Not a one of those nations do you lose their Social Security, by the way, is called Flex Security. Not a one person loses Flex Security funding. They say, what are you doing in America? You're taking away people's Social Security that was determined based on their disability. Their disability did not go away because they started working. Don't take that away. If you take that away, people are likely going to say, but forget it. Forget work. I'm not doing that. I'm going to lose that. I might starve to death if I lost my job then, right? So, again, aversion bias. Confirmation bias. We only see what we want to believe is true. Something that confirms what's already in our head. Proximity bias. We only believe what's near. I consulted in 43 states. I've never gone to a state that doesn't say, well, we don't want to find out what's going on in California or Massachusetts or Colorado or Florida or that stuff. Just tell me what's going on in a state nearby. Because we're kind of in the same boat. Kansas, Nebraska. Yeah, tell me what's going on in Nebraska if I'm in Kansas. Tell me what's going on in North Carolina if I'm in Georgia. Tell me what's something going on nearby, Illinois and Indiana. Don't tell me what's going on, obviously California and other West Coast states. So again, we have a bias to only listen to where folks are. Simplicity bias. If something is simple, then we believe it. If it's not simple, if it's too complex, we don't. It's like, honey, where were you? Oh yeah, I needed to stop to get gas, and then I went in to get a pack of smokes. And talking about the old days, of course, went in to get a pack of smokes, and came out. You know what? I met a friend there, and when he was looking at the car, it turned out I have a flat tire. So I talked to the friend some, and went over and need to get the tire pumped up with air, and then. What's the spouse going to say or loved one? How come you're lying to me? Again, when reason after reason after reason is given of why you should go the customized employment route instead of the support employment route or whatever the situation is, if you give too many reasons, it's like, why are you lying? Why do you have to try so hard to try to buttress this? Obviously, it must be not true. Remember, this is a bias. In other words, it means that whenever somebody is telling us a lot of reasons to do something, human beings across planet Earth, everywhere, start, I don't know, they gotta say all that about it. It may not be right. And then situation bias. Well, and I have told people I work with for years and years, please do not do the best you can given the time you got. No, don't do the right things as time allows. Don't do the best you can given the time you got. Do things right. Do things well. Don't say, well, right, we're in an election controversy right now, right? And what do people keep saying? How about us doing this right? Wouldn't that be a good idea? We're going to do this right. No, let's get the vote now. Oh, what's now? What is it right now? No. Remember, we want to do things right, not just do it as much as time allows. Same principle. Okay. Sunk costs. This is one that's, you know, just think about things around your house that you wish you hadn't bought. But once you buy something, you think, dang, I got the wrong thing. But you've already sunk those costs, and then are you going to make a change? And oftentimes, no, we're kind of stuck with whatever we got. In other words, we end up not happy because of whatever it is, because once we made an opportunity, we don't then change and do the right thing. So once I've been, look, I did all this investment and all this research in supported employment or in enclaves or, you know, group homes or whatever it is for people with disabilities, then no, I can't change now. I got too many sunk costs in there. Missed opportunity costs. One of the least understood things. People think, well, if I'm not making a decision, I can't be wrong because I didn't make a decision. Wrong. All the research, somebody wants to get their PhD, boom, here's what to get it on. Opportunity costs, missed opportunity. All the decisions, people make a decision, and you've heard before, not making a decision is actually making a decision. That's what this is. It's saying that you don't realize all the things that might be lost by not taking that opportunity. When I had to talk the Goodwill in Colorado Springs into doing community integrated employment instead of doing sheltered workshops, you know, it took a lot of talking and a lot of work and a lot of work on my behalf. I was over all the money. I was the boss of the whole regional area of Colorado Springs and other counties. At the same time, I'm not an authoritarian leader. I want people to convince people to do things, the right things, because it makes sense and because we have evidence it makes sense. So they did make that transition out of, and they were one of the most successful Goodwills and in the nation, by the way, completely transitioned to all community integrated employment. And guess what happened? They got so successful at that, they said, Steve, you were completely right, and we did what you did, but we're missing about $400,000 in our budget because people actually don't need our services so much. The people are all out there all working, you know, so we don't need this building anymore. We're losing money by being in this building. What are we going to do? So, well, you need to be thinking about, you know, all kinds of different things. And I didn't have much of an answer for them, but I had an answer later. I wanted them to kind of figure it out. But they figured it out themselves. They said, let's expand to being able to take this technology and use it for other people. So what they did was they began helping people who were homeless get jobs. They helped people, they went into heavily into mental health get jobs. They went into helping people who had been incarcerated or in prison before get jobs. In other words, they ended up with their company, their corporation, expanding sixfold. In other words, they made more money, helped more people, did everything by doing the right thing than not. Again, that type of missed opportunity cost by sticking what you're doing is not it. I mean, that doesn't work so well. Anchoring, you're tied with whatever's familiar, what's known. Kind of, well, this is what I know. This is what I've always done. So I'm going to keep doing that. Framing means, you know, how somebody says the truth determines what it is. I won't talk much more about that. And then economy of scale versus diseconomy of scale. You type in diseconomy of scale sometime and all you'll come up with, I'm talking about in a web engine, all you'll come up with is stuff on economy of scale. But once in a while, if you look farther, finally there'll be one something on diseconomy of scale. In other words, wait a minute, does the research show that the reason why, do people put people in group homes because it's less expensive and can be done better by putting four or six or eight people in one house than it is by putting one or two people in a house? And almost everybody say, yeah, that's why they do it. Because see, you know, the staff then oversee a whole lot of different people. And so it's better, you know, it costs less. What's the data show? The data shows wrong. It actually costs more because there's all kinds of issues going on. Not just missed opportunity costs, it is, but all kinds of things going on that actually cost more. They'll just bring up one. Just the fire alarm and fire mitigation system in any home that has more than four people living in, more than three people living in it, is an enormous investment that's not there when you have fewer people. So just as an example. Okay, let's stop there in the middle of biases. Do you have questions about this?
If anyone would like to type in the chat or unmute to ask a question, feel free. Not seeing anything in the chat box right now, Steve.
Okay. So it's so easy to say, what's those folks out there? People out there. That's why, you know, we can't get the powers that be to agree with us. That's why that must be it. It must be the powers that be don't understand. But what this presentation is saying is, wait a minute, let's take a look at yourself. Let's find out where those biases are. Realize other people that may have biases. Again, four Nobel Prize winners are saying, yep, they sure do. Everybody's got these biases. In India, they got them. Italy, they got them. You know, wherever people are, they got these same biases. So maybe there might be something we need to do to think about how we're doing things. And what it looks like the answer may be is find evidence, slow down your thinking, and see and really take a look at something when somebody presents something new to you. Okay, so just a couple real quick. We're influenced by those, by who communicates information. So you don't know me. Yeah, it's somebody who knows me really well, then may be heavily influenced by what, or they may say, no, I'm not listening to that. but they may be heavily influenced by whatever. So again, whoever's telling us these things may be important. When I did work in Eastern Kentucky in coal mining regions that were, you know, some of the poorest people in the United States lived there. And I went there. You know, I knew right away, first words out of my mouth were, I want you to know this. I said, my wife is from Kentucky. And here's what she told me. She says, you don't have any idea what those people want, what they need, or what they or what is of interest to them. So what you need to do is go over there. You need to get up in front of them and let them know that you're going to shut your mouth and you're going to listen to what they have to say. And then they'll trust you, because if you get up there talking about all the things that you think they should be doing, they're going to smile at you. They're going to say, hey, would you like another piece of cake, Commissioner? Whatever. They're going to be the nicest, sweetest people. And they just can't wait till you leave. But if you tell them that you don't know what it is that they want or need for their children, disabilities and others, then they'll listen to you. And of course, their overwhelming response is, you have a very intelligent wife and you better listen to her. And then guess what? That broke the ice. And they not only did I listen to them, they listened to me, because it became, they knew I understood. So that's about influence and about, influence by others about how to communicate. We tend to go with the flow and we pay attention to what's personally relevant to ourselves. Okay, couple more. We're drawn to what's new and different. Subconscious cues, don't even know. Emotional associations. You ever see all these commercials they have? They have children and playing and all that. They're doing that because what they're, whenever you have children in any type of on the screen, they've shown that, again, behavioral economics economists have studied this. They show that we're willing to take far more risks whenever there's children around because we're happy. Happy children means the world is right and we're willing to do a whole lot of good things just by having children. In other words, basically to buy a new car, to buy a particular, a TV or a piece of audio equipment that somebody's selling. Okay. I'll just do a few more. We keep promises we made, right or wrong. It's that idea of sunk costs. Well, I'll keep my promise, even if it's wrong, not a good idea. We take actions that make us feel better about ourselves and avoid conflicts. Okay. Cost, benefit, opportunity, dignity analysis. Here is the question. Are you in a double dignity job? Here's the answer. Yes, you are. Everybody that's likely on this webinar is in what's called a double dignity job by the leading economists in the United States, the economists that have worked directly with the presidents of our country. A double dignity job. Here's what a double dignity job is. It's a job that pays pretty well, doesn't make you rich, but it pays pretty well for the work you're doing. And the work you're doing is helping somebody else that does not have, that life isn't going for them so well. You're helping them succeed too. Now, so not only are you succeeding, but they are succeeding too. That's a double dignity job. That means that both you have dignity in the great work that you're doing to help citizens with significant challenges to employment and disabilities get jobs, but you're also the person that's a recipient gets a whole load of dignity in life now, because now they are not isolated, congregated, and segregated and away from the society, but they then are a part of society too. Double dignity jobs. Here's some good news. These jobs, double dignity jobs, are going to expand like wild. That this is the area that's going to have the highest growth, because as machinery and technology and everything replaces a whole bunch of technology, replaces a whole bunch of jobs, how those jobs are going to be replaced are the jobs like you have right now, jobs where you're both in a job that brings you dignity, brings you respect, means that you had to go through something to get that job, means that you have coworkers that care about you, that believe in you, all the dignity that comes with that. We take so for granted, but it's most of our jobs that work on behalf of people with disabilities are exactly like that, except for obviously DSPs that are far, direct support professionals that are far underpaid. That's a huge problem. Obviously, they need to have much more money, have much more training. I mean, huge investments there, because their jobs oftentimes are not leading. They're caretaking. Sometimes they are not leading to people. They're maintaining. They're keeping people out of the institution, and that's good. But we're not getting all that we could, because we're not making the investments in this workforce. So oftentimes people leave those jobs sometimes and go to employment where they can both help people and more income for themselves. So double dignity jobs is what we're looking for. We're looking for people like most of the people that are on here that are going to build new relationships for people with disabilities and for themselves. Okay. Other questions? Anything?
Not right now. No, Steve.
Good. Okay. Probabilities and possibilities. We tend to think in probabilities. Oh, this will probably happen, or that probably won't happen. Stop doing that. This is saying customized employment. This is a world of possibilities. As Kerry Griffin said, that you remember the fast that discovery is the it's in customized employment. It's the fastest way to a good job. And we can get jobs fast. We can get all kinds of lousy jobs fast. But to a good job, it's the fastest way to a good job. And that comes the benchmark, the methodology within customized employment, which we're not going to go through today, all what it says is possibilities, possibilities, possibilities. Whenever you meet somebody, you try to expand that to somebody else. You meet an employer, you ask, well, who else does this sort of work? Who else does this kind of thing? What other subcontracts do you might have with other companies? In other words, you're expanding potential places where the person you're working on behalf of can get a job by thinking possibilities, 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 not, oh, probably I found a place where the person will hire them. No, it's about what, wait a minute, how the promise of customized employment is the, you get the ideal conditions of employment. And with that, the only way to do that is possibilities expanding. That is driving towards uncertainty instead of certainty, not trying to narrow in and focus in on where is this person going to work. That's not what we're doing. We're going out always pretending, and it's usually we're 100% right about this pretend, that we're the most ignorant, the least knowledgeable person in the room when we're contacting an employer or a business that's involved in doing the type of work that the person we're working on behalf of, the job seeker, that they want to do. So we're there to learn information and about all the possibilities and types of work that might be possible in this environment. So think possibilities, not probabilities. And by the way, like the same thing, type up into a search engine, type in possibility theory, you'll come up with probability theory, probability theory. Well, I didn't type in probability theory. I typed in possibility theory. What's it doing? And finally you'll go down, wait, well, there it is. It says possibility theory. What is this? And you find out, wait a minute, this is a whole different way of operating, thinking, you know, what's going on. And they've used it from everything for smart washing machines to smart TVs. All that was created not on probability theory, but was created on possibility theory. But I won't go into all the details, just so you know, the top scientists in the world, they're all thinking possibility theory and not probability theory. All right, discovery scale fidelity, this fidelity scale data, something I'm calling great unexpectations. In other words, I'm giving you data that nobody else has. I've not talked to anybody really much about this. Here you go. Here's what we found out about the data that we're, when we get people jobs from the data we have that we're going to, we've published, one article, we just submitted a second article to be published in the rehabilitation, first one in the Journal of Vocational Rehabilitation on the Discovery Fidelity Scale. We published a second article in the Journal, the Rehabilitation, in another rehabilitation journal on the Job Development Fidelity Scale. We're publishing a third article. We're working on a third article we're publishing on what early data we have coming out of this project where we're working in 10 states with people to help them develop fidelity to best practices using these fidelity scales. So here's what we know is that when you go to the home visit, it's not so important to learn about the person's employment interests or their preferences during the home visit. Big mistake people make. You find out in the first 45 minutes what the person's interested in. You spend the whole rest of the time in discovery and customized employment trying to make that what your original assumption is true. And what you're trying to do, it's called that's the confirmation bias at work, what I talked about earlier. What you're trying to do is confirm your original assumption that this person said they were interested in computers, they had a dog there that they petted, whatever it is that's going on, it's confirming what we already think in the first 45 minutes of meeting the person. It's saying, don't worry about that then. What you want to do at that home visit is find out who is this person? Who is this person? Don't start going on to that employment interests or preferences right off the gate. Well, we're here for employment, aren't we? No, we're not. We're not here for employment. What we're here at that home visit to do is to find out who is this person? Consultative employment specialist comes into the home visit. So what we're saying is the person that was formerly known as a job coach, we have some data and research that now says it'd be a really great idea to have somebody else that's going to do the consultative employment besides the person who's right there doing discovery and is likely going to do customized job development, bring that person right there with you at that initial home visit so they can say, and by the way, when you do get a job, I'll see you down the road. I'll be helping you. And we do that early introduction so they're not popping on that job site from out of the blue and saying, oh, by the way, I'm the new person. It's going to be, I'm going to be your consultative employment specialist or your job coach. I'm going to work with you here. It's like, who are you? I've been working with this person the whole time. Early introduction, just new data. All right. What you're supposed to do with that home visit again, learn about current friendships, relationships, contacts, connections, places, contacts. And when you're trying to spread out again, you're trying to get all the information about that. It appears that's very, very critical to success in customized employment. Find out every connection that person might possibly have in every aspect. Okay. DFS data. Here's some more. Don't ever place a person a job they already have the skills to do. That is not, none of you, nobody on this screen has a job, if you're in a good job, that you know how to do before you got it. Every lousy job are only the jobs that you already know how to do before you ever got them. Every good job meant you didn't know how to do it. You got the job based on whatever assets or attributes or what you brought to the job. You got the job. That's great. You learned the job because you had somebody there that believes in you. Again, hopefully the boss and a supervisor and also a coworker or more. And that is how we succeeded. Every job I had all these degrees and did all this great training and everything. No, it was not, none of my success was based on that. Every bit of success of my entire life was based on others who believed in me, took a chance on me, who said, I'll help you and that sort of thing. So just know, but we're finding out that about people with disabilities, it's really careful. Be careful. Don't place people in jobs with skills they already know how to do. All good jobs, you pick up the skills to do the job from the coworkers after you get there. It just means you're just finding out how they learn and how they're best supported. But well, that's another subject. There it is. How the person learns and how they're best supported. That's what you're trying to find out during that. And you're trying to do far. And what you should do is far, far more informational interviews than you're doing. I'm finding people are doing informational interviews. This person has three vocational themes. They're doing one each, sometimes two each. We should be doing a lot more informational interviews than we're doing right now to find out much, much more about what a person's interest is. That takes time, takes a little bit more money. I'm just saying that part of customized employment needs to be expanded. Question would be, yeah, that all sounds well and good, but have you noticed we have this thing called the coronavirus going on and people are dying? Yes, I'm very aware of that. This presentation is not about how can you adapt these kind of things for the coronavirus. I strongly suggest that you go to the Griffin-Hammis website. We have webinars out the wazoo on all the details that might be suggestions, great webinars that others have given about how to implement some of the all the things I'm saying and other things. How do you make adaptations of that during this time of social distancing? So everything, as you might guess, everything I'm saying works far better when when people are vaccinated and the coronavirus has diminished as it has in some other countries. So when we get to that point in our country, which hopefully I'm hoping will be by next summer, then we are late fall at the latest, then a lot of these things become more true and working. So know that. So I apologize for that. Didn't say it at the beginning, but no, there's information there. Let me keep going so that I, let's keep going. All right. When you do a discovery, they're looking for a story. You know, what vocational rehabilitation counselors have said, you know, I just love when I get a discovery because it reads like a story. It tells me the reasoning and analysis of why you're doing what you're doing. You're not just saying what happened. Well, we did this. We went to the home and we did this. And we went to the discovery activity and we did this. We went to the less familiar discovery activity and we did this. And then we went over and did informational interviews at these three employers. And here's what their names are. That's not a story. That's just tell them back. That's not what this is. Write these vocation, write the entire discovery process down. Say what happened and say what you learned from what happened and say what the result of your thinking was with that. That's what should be in the vocational profile part of the discovery data, of the discovery plan you're writing. Other information, you always should decide who the best person is to contact the business during customized employment job development. In other words, sometimes it's not the job developer. Sometimes another person is best to make that first contact. So CE job development fidelity scale, great expectations from it. Just two things. What I just said, CE job developer may not be the messenger. You may want someone else to help with that. And then second is building social capital. You're thinking all the long time, how do I develop contacts, connections, relationships, and friendships during job development? So what you're trying to do there is develop relationships. When I was a CEO of an organization, I had all kinds of social capital because of being a CEO and all these relationships in the community. And I look back on that, what I was doing is stealing the social capital of people with disabilities by not realizing that what my job should have been, even as a CEO, was to drive it so that people with disabilities develop contacts, connections, relationships, and friendships during job development. This presentation is not about how to do that. I certainly understand how to do that, but it's just saying to keep that kind of thinking. It's, wait a minute, we're not just supposed to be going out there trying to find jobs. We're supposed to be getting this person more contacts, connections, and relationships. Remember what you're doing here. You're implementing a psychosocial habilitation and rehabilitation methodology when you're doing community integrated employment. And part of that is building social capital. Okay, JDFS negotiation, everything is negotiated. And people even who have done customized employment for a while says, give me a break, are you kidding me? You're going out there and you're gonna say to employers, you're gonna tell them No. The employer decides what the job is. And if you want it, you can have it. But we're not going to negotiate the job. Wrong. It turns out that there's no evidence at all of employers being against negotiation. Instead, they're the opposite. They're, thank you for telling me that the person would be able to do all these parts of the job, but would definitely not be able to do that part of the job. Well, I can just make this little adaptation for somebody else to do that part of the job. And by the way, here's this other part of the job. Now you told me that probably they'd like to do. So no problem. We're all good. Happens every day in customized employment. Always negotiate everything. Make it right. Make the job really great. Not just, oh, they had that one part they can't do. I guess I hope he struggles through it. Don't do that to somebody. Employment training plan is critical to happen during JDFS. I won't talk any more about that. Okay. Brand new. The consultative employment training fidelity scale, you are the first people in the United States to hear anything about it. So here it comes. This will not be, I will not be done with this till around Christmas time, and it won't be out and be able to be used of use except for people associated, which many people on this webinar are people associated with Easterseals of Southern California. So obviously they're going to get first shot. They're helping finance all of this research and these fidelity scales that's being used again now in 10 states. So first shot will be in Southern California, then other states probably by May, but probably as early as March or maybe even earlier in Southern California. So primary coworker trains a new employee. Job developer stays around, doesn't just leave after the job. They actually stay around and work with consultative employment specialists at the job. And then the wages of the consultative employment specialists are the same as the CE job developer. So there's some really big things. It means consultative training employment specialist, the person that used to be a job coach, getting well paid now, getting paid like a job developer. Job developers also staying around. They're double teaming for about 2 weeks on the job. And here says the primary coworker is training the new employee. Who says this? Who's saying this is the research I've done, again, this was across seven different states, talking to everybody, trying to find whoever the best and the brightest is doing this work. What are the modifications and changes that they've made? That's how stuff ends up, you know, in the scale, in addition to everything that's taught by the experts, some 30 other experts we've talked to about it. Okay. Let's see. I think that covers it. Oh, and funding transition from VR to IDD or VH actually for behavioral health happens during consultative employment training. Okay. A few other things on consultative employment training. It matters what the employee is doing in non-work hours. We're finding if they're in isolated, only with other people with disabilities, doing the same stuff that they always did, it interferes with the job, makes them lose their jobs, encourages them to lose their jobs because their parents say, do you really have to work all the time? Why don't we just do what we did before where they picked you up at the house so I don't have to drive you over there, particularly in bad weather. Things are happening in ordinary and customary ways at the job. Again, I won't get into all the details about that, but it's really, really important to learn the ordinary and customary ways things happen at a job. Helps people be much more successful. And the consultative employment specialist trains, teaches, and advises, too. So they're training, teaching, and advising, not just the helping with the citizen, the job seeker. They're also advising the coworker. All right. Okay, I mentioned about dignity. And so before, I won't go into this any further, but it turns out to be it's one of the most important thing is it turns out is the work culture. You know, because we used to think the skills might be more important. No, it's important to learn skills, but what really people keep their jobs, what mainly makes it successful is that works culture alongside other coworkers. People, you know, all the research that Harvard did years ago was absolutely correct. People will absolutely leave their jobs if they have a great job, but the people that they work with every day, they don't like, or they don't respect them. They don't treat them with dignity. People will walk out of jobs that are great jobs if they don't like the people that they're working alongside of. And just the opposite, people will stay in jobs that aren't so good. They don't like the work so much, but they love their coworkers. They love their boss. They love how they're treated. So it turns out that the work culture is gigantic. And all these, there's a lot of different, there's some tenets built into the new Fidelity scale for consultative that will address that. Other things, reasonable accommodations, changes to ordinary work processes. I won't say more about that. It's going to too many details on it. Okay, this is the third to the last slide. What we're saying is only spend taxpayer dollars for services and supports that have the research evidence to support the outcome. It's saying, okay, we're spending $84 billion. Wouldn't it be a great idea, rather than just getting somewhere south of $1 billion of those dollars nationwide, wouldn't it be a great idea to move substantial amounts of those dollars, at least 5 to 10 billion of the 64 billion, to give it to people like are on this webinar to be able to deliver customized employment, jobs that last, jobs that have people working side by side with other citizens as integral parts of the community. How about that as an idea, particularly if we have the research evidence that these particular practices, if practiced, will likely bring success, and we have the proof of that. Last slide, second to last slide is questions.
So we have a question in the chat box from Matthew Barenci from Department of Rehabilitation.
Okay, cool.
His question is, to clarify regarding consultative employment training, are there three people providing on-site support, the coworker, the job developer, the consultative employment trainer for the newly placed job seeker, or does the coworker act as the consultative employment trainer?
Yeah, so a great question, great question. There's an overlap. You see, all types of rehabilitation that have been purchased by vocational rehabilitation through all time have been a part of, and by the way, through Medicaid, through all time, have not hesitated to have people billing at the same time for delivering different aspects. This is key. Different aspects of the same service. In other words, if the data says that you need to have a 2-week period of time, because that's what it is, just 2 weeks, 2-week period of time where the job developer, the consultative employment specialist, and the person who is the coworker, the person who is primarily responsible for training, all being potentially paid for, I'll save that coworker part till later, but paid for at the same time, that's cool. It costs a little bit extra money because they're doing different aspects of the service. And again, that gets into the details of what the role is in consultative employment specialist of the consultative employment specialist and what the role is of the job developer, because their roles at that site concurrently are different. Because the biggest myth that there is that, oh, no, that's double billing. We can't pay for two things at once. We can't, we're paying for it. Now you're asking to pay for it twice over 2 weeks. No, we're not asking to pay for the same thing twice. There's definitely different aspects of that. And it's actually routine and customary, has been throughout all time with psychosocial rehabilitation methodologies. But for some reason, many of us got stuck in our head, myself early on, that, oh, well, that somehow means that only one person can be paid on that hour. You can't pay. No, sometimes services are so significant that they need some overlap of people providing different aspects. So the answer is only one person is the consultative employment specialist, and that's the person who is the consultative employment specialist that is replacing the job coach. What this is saying is that the job developer also hangs out, does a whole bunch of stuff for 2 weeks to make that transition work well. And again, I have, you know, information and data after data about that. And there's a couple organizations in the United States already doing that, already got this. And there's nothing I'm bringing up that hasn't been already worked out, made sure that it's all legal and straight and all good. So know that. Now, here's where things get interesting. The law says that VR should not spend a dime and hand anybody any money to teach somebody skills on a job unless that person has the qualifications and ability to teach those skills. Yet there's what we've been doing now for decades. We've been handing money to rehabilitation agencies who have been paying job coaches who don't have the actual skill to know the actual job. And so guess what jobs we've been getting people in menial labor, you know, in jobs that are low skilled. Or if some people a little meaner talk about it as the food filth mop and slop initiatives, only placing people in jobs that nobody else wants, cleaning up after some people, wiping, mopping, carrying out stuff, taking out trash, or whatever it is, those kind of jobs, which are nothing but glorified chores. So what to be able to get people in really good jobs, then who's going to teach those? The person that has the skills is that coworker. Now, if you're in Europe, in any of the 30 European countries, they get that easy, you know, and everybody can see real quick what it's getting at. It's another form of on-the-job training, of course. And what it is, oh, well, now I get it. Yeah, exactly. Make sure the person who knows the job is teaching that. But there's not another role, a person who really knows how the person learns, how they're best supported, and it's a disability expert to be there also engaged. Now, the question is, which we won't resolve here, is in the United States, are we going to pay for that coworker to also for their time in doing whatever? And again, all 30 European countries say, well, absolutely, of course, we're going to do that. But in the United States, that's happening just to a very limited amount of people. Like, okay, we really get it. We need to have somebody there that know that's doing the skill training, but another person doing the consultative support that knows what they're doing. And then the job developer, shepherding the process to make sure that everything that they learned during discovery during customized employment, job development is actually happening and covering a lot of other issues involving the work culture and other sorts of things. So, but anyway, again, in this limited time, can't get that, but I hope that answered your question. So yeah, that's a piece. And so that's gotta be worked out, because remember that a provider is paying money for those employees. They're getting a salary. So we gotta be sure that whatever rate that we build in for a rate, then it is covers an overlap of personnel during that time. Okay.
That was a great question. Thank you.
Fantastic question. Fantastic. Yeah,
perfect. And actually, it came up yesterday. Steve and I were going over a fidelity scale, and that was one of the things we discussed, was that process. So it's very timely.
Yeah. See, it doesn't mean that you say, well, wait a minute, if I'm paying $65 an hour, then I got to pay two people $65 an hour. No. It means that if you know your costs, if you do a net cost analysis of where that $65 are going, and then you know that some part in the process, then to do that work, the provider agency, because it has a double cost there, it means that the $65 an hour rate, and now I'm just guessing, over all the hours that the person may be working, needs to simply go up to $67 an hour. That's all. In other words, it's just like, oh, you mean it just means a $2 gain in that? Will that cover just the 2 week period of time that those people are at the same time? Answer, yes. So there's ways to finance that doesn't mean, oh, you get a bill for 65 and I get a bill for 65. No, we're not doing anything like that. It just means that we make sure that the rate has the costs built in it right from the get-go. And then we hold people accountable for doing this work with fidelity to best practices. We make sure that is occurring. They're doing it. They're, in other words, that we're getting what we paid for. Okay. Thank you. Great question.
And Matthew has, he says, thanks, Steve. One more question. When we say we need quote unquote far more informational interviews, what are we seeing versus what is considered ideal, i.e. what is a current recommended average?
Oh God, Matthew, where have you been? I should have just had you answer. I mean, ask me these questions and people would be a lot more useful than that. Okay. Yeah, fantastic question again. Well, here's what they're saying. We got data. Listen to this. 1 out of 3 people are jumping to the job during informational interviews. Jumping to the job on the first informational interview. In other words, what they're doing is they're going out, say, we're in discovery. Okay, let's go to an informational interview. And you know where they're going? They're going to places that they know will hire people with disabilities because of some history or in the past. And they're going where the people they already know is hiring. And guess what? Because of discovery and because of this great relationship with the job developer or even during discovery, but let's say it's done by the job developer, because of that relationship, then they get them a job. And of course the VR counselor is going, woohoo, all right, status 26 coming, got him a job during discovery, and that's great. They're like, no, it's not great. What happened is you shortchange the discovery process. And then the person will end up likely, again, the data showing that after 18 months or sooner, between 12 and 18 months, that person's going to not be in that job. They'll be rotating back in. In other words, you shortchanged the person by not fully doing the discovery process. So do the full discovery process. And then with that. So that's first of all, the data is that showing too many people are jumping to the job at the first informational interview. So that's the worst case scenario. Common scenario, if they have 3 vocational themes, they're going to 1 or maybe 2 at the most vocational thing, informational interview used with employers for each vocational theme. In other words, they're getting between 3 and 6 informational interviews because I think that's enough. And we just, this is what we're getting paid for. And we can't spend much time doing this or whatever they're thinking, or because it's a hassle and setting them up. I don't know what all that is. Well, I do know what all it is, but it's all those things. And instead, we need to be expanding possibilities. In other words, you're out there not to find a job. Okay, that's job development. And during discovery, you're out there to expand possibilities, to find out all the type of work that goes on in that area. How much time do we have, Pam? Are we still okay or not?
Oh yeah, we've got almost half an hour.
Okay, well, let me just say this real quickly. It's like I live in Kentucky, where horse racing is. Okay, so horse racing. So if people know horses or think they know horses or whatever, I think I know what horses are. There's horses, and there must be some horse racing, and there's horses, all kind of stuff. No, you don't have any idea about horses. You have no idea about the horse industry, and I don't either. I'm not in the horse industry. But if I was in the horse industry, here's some things that you don't know about the horse industry. For example, if I ask everyone on this webinar, what is the number one crop in the United States? You know, number one crop. We could sit here the rest of the day, and you name all the crops. You'd say, oh, it's wheat. I think it's soybeans. I think it's corn. I think it's, if you're in California, it's oranges or Florida oranges or tomatoes or I don't know, it's something like that. No, all of it be wrong. None of it in money. The billions and billions of dollars that's made off this crop and all of this crop is, it's the number one crop in the United States. And if you ask the question, nobody knows the answer, right? Here's the answer. It's grass seed. It's grass seed. That's the number one crop grown in the United States. And the grass that's in your yard in California was likely developed by a couple professors working at the University of Kentucky to make the best grass seed possible for racehorses to live on. So again, people, literally the world, by the way, grass seed for the world is made based on, and if you've ever seen the life insurance policy of a thoroughbred racehorse, I guarantee you this, a thoroughbred racehorse is worth a whole lot more than a human being, at least according to insurance companies. So know that here is an extremely valuable animal that they do everything, including completely changing what grass is. So that animal will not get injured, will enjoy its life, and will breed well, again, other racehorses, on this great, great, beautiful, Kentucky or wherever the horses are in California, you know, down in San Diego way, in great and beautiful places. So anyway, you would know that grass seed was an important part of the horse industry, or leather. Wherever there's horses, leather industry is gigantic, gigantic. And you can see quickly on all the reasons why the leather industry would be huge there. So you don't know. So when you go into an area to find out about, well, I'm interested in horses, and find out about it, you didn't have any idea that the whole, there's got this whole grass seed side of it. There's a whole leather side of it. And if you're in like places like Kentucky, you have one of the largest gambling industries in the world that comes out of Churchill Downs in Louisville. You know, that literally people in all over the entire planet and every country are betting almost daily on something that is run out of one office inside of the Churchill Downs racetrack. So anyway, so all of that is not something we know. So that's just one example. So that's why when you go into these informational interviews, you think about expanding. Well, who else do you do this work with? Who else? And then you think they'd mind if I talk to them about, oh yeah, no, you know what? I'll go ahead and call them and tell them you're coming. Look what just happened. You're at an employer and the employer is now making the referral, making the contact to somebody, recommending you go there to talk to them about the job and the work that's going on. So anyway, that's what I mean by more informational interviews, is that you just expand. And when you get used to doing it, it will blow your mind about all the things and possibilities there are for jobs that you just didn't even imagine that they were there or interrelated or is possible. Okay.
Matthew, did that answer your question? Or were you looking for like a number or a range? He said, that's great. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah.
Other questions that people have? We've still got a little time. While we're waiting for any other questions to come through, Steve, I was wondering if you might be able to explain a little bit more about what you mentioned regarding quote unquote stealing social capital, just maybe a little bit more about that and being aware of the fidelity sure. with that step. That would be great. Thank you.
Well, I was a CEO in Colorado Springs, pretty well close to paradise, and it's a multi-million-dollar organization. And then I increased the revenue in that organization at over four times, hired folks. I had less than 3% staff turnover. We were rocking and rolling. We ran out of people with disabilities to get jobs. Everybody that even remotely wanted a job was in a job. We closed group homes. We closed sheltered workshops. Got rid of segregation. Did as close as we could to creating paradise for people with disabilities, and it all worked great. Colorado had a very unusual law that allowed me to set my own rates. No place in the whole country has this. I don't think Colorado even has it now. But had a really strange fluke in the law since 1961 that allowed individual providers to set their rates. So I took advantage of that to really promote full integration and inclusion of people with disabilities long before a lot of places were doing that. So wait a minute. What was the question again, Pam? I got off a little bit. What was the question again? Oh, about
the social capital. About the social capital and the quote unquote
So social capital, what I did then was I became friends of the fire chief, the police chief. I went to Denver Bronco football games, with the fire chief, Mary Lou Makepeace, who was the mayor at the time, and I were friends. Not just met in meetings together, but we were friends. I mean, in other words, I even trained with the police department because I was, one of the leaders of the community and all that. And anybody had a disability, they say, oh, go talk to Steve. Just go see, he knows everything. Oh, yeah, he knows everything about what your son or daughter needs and all that. Yeah, we did all kinds of great work. No, here's what I would have done different. What I was doing was stealing the social capital of people with disabilities, stealing it and keeping it all for myself, building the agency, building my own credibility, all the things that were happening that were in, yes, lots of wonderful, wonderful things happened with people with disabilities. Once we figured out how to connect with the churches in Colorado Springs, and particularly with those church secretaries, by the way, you talk about smart people. There's who you want. If you want to know what's really happening in the community, go to a church secretary. They know everything. Ministers are great, nice people, but church secretaries are the bomb for knowing where every job is and every contact there could be. Anyway, so I did all that. What I was doing is taking social capital away from people with disabilities and keeping it for myself and for the organization. Okay, how to do that differently now is this. When you're doing customized employment, you're always thinking about how can I build relationships, friendships, contacts, and connections with this citizen I'm helping and other citizens in the community. I mean, your whole way of going about things is trying to connect people with things that are both work-related and not work-related. In the community, because you're trying to build a person's social capital. And I'll just say this, I know this is a broad sweep and not always the case, but people who largely have been denied full access to the community because of their disability and because of these disability systems attended out of the best of intentions, but how these disability systems tend to isolate, congregate, create giant regional centers, all kinds of things that they do to be able to say, well, we're going to help these people that other people won't. But what we've done in doing that is we've tended to isolate people for a lifetime, literally. And it's both affected society of how society thinks about people and other people. And it also affects, obviously, people with disabilities. So what this is saying is that as you do things, that you're always trying to build those connections with that person. I mean, with the person with disability. And when you're trying to, if you look at it from a step back point of view, what you're trying to do is simply replace the all of the things that may have been stolen from them because of society's inability to see the possibilities in people with this have significant differences than most of us. And instead we're fearful and isolated them for, again, a lot of good reasons that they thought, but it turned out that the impact of that has been very negative for the people, shorter lives, way overuse of pharmacological products, obesity, metabolic syndrome, many different things that physically, literally shortened people's lives and made their lives not nearly as nice as they could be. So to repair that, we have a process that can only take place in the lifeblood of the community. We're mostly concerned about employment, but also, about building these relationships the way most of us have. Okay, so did I answer it, Pam?
Yes, thank you. That was helpful. Okay.
Yeah, it's about going through life, thinking about connections, that sort of thing. Now, remember, I'm weird on this, so I have to even know that a tree has 37% of the same DNA that I have. So I think about the world differently. I'm not saying everybody to think the way I do, but I think about the world differently in that a lot of things that people would say are inanimate or even dead, I think about them much differently than most. In other words, just think about connections. I guess I would say that. But I guess I'll just leave it at that. There, if you want to know more about that, I could certainly give you resources that would talk about that. I'll say this little hint. Is a person named Lynn Margolis was given the given a very prestigious honor by President Clinton, given the Medal of Honor, Science Medal of Honor by the President. She was likely going to get the Nobel Prize a few years later, but died suddenly. And Lynn Margolis's research, heard of Carl Sagan before. Lynn Margolis was Carl Sagan's wife. And Lynn Margolis is a smart one. To give you some idea, if you know who Carl Sagan is, you'll know that if I'm saying this, that his wife is far smarter than he is, he ever thought about being, But anyway, she discovered a different way of interacting and about what kind of all things about life. And I asked my friend Will, who is a biologist, he is working on the COVID research, and does liver transplants. And I said, Will, did you know about Lynn Margolis and all her work? He goes, Steve, I'm a biologist. Of course I know about Lynn Margolis. I said, well, how come the biology textbooks aren't teaching this? And he said, it'll freak everybody out. He says, they're not going to teach it. Just like when with volcanoes and earthquakes, we knew that the answer to volcanoes and earthquakes, that was written in a 1904 paper about what causes volcanoes and earthquakes, which was plate tectonics. But it never appeared until the middle of the 1980s in anybody's textbooks because people would freak out. They would want to think it's mysterious forces is the reason why volcanoes are going off or earthquakes are happening or whatever, that they didn't know that it's actually based on solid science. Well, same as this, Lynn Margolis has proven that the world actually works so far differently than we do, than we think. And the people will freak out if they find out that it's very different. So it'll appear in the kids' textbooks in the year about 2050. We'll get to know about it. But anyway, I say all that just for people to know that I just believe similar to what Lynn Margolis is teaching. And you can look up anything about her and see what it all is. But what I just believe that interactions between people has proven, and then we're taking data and research on this, that you want to drive towards all you can, getting people connected with other people and other things and other parts of life and other places as much as possible And that ends up with a healthier, happier, more successful person, rather than isolating them, finding out what they can't do, what they can do, and only concentrated on what they can do. Instead, we want to let a coworker, let the research, you know, prove that it's that the main thing that makes a job work, like it did for everyone that's on this webinar, is you had a coworker or maybe more or a boss that believed in you. And that's why you're successful. It wasn't just all that you did on your own. So that's what that is about. But I got a little off there on the Lynn Margolis stuff, but maybe somebody will look it up and look at her videos and different things like that, and will say, "Well, oh my God, I didn't have any idea that when Steve said that an oak tree is 37% have the same DNA, I had no idea that this was what really is going on." So, yeah. Okay. Did everybody leave on that? Pam, everybody says that's enough of that.
No, we still have folks on here. People are saying thank you. Yeah. Any other questions that people want to ask, type in the chat or just unmute. We'd be happy to answer them. We've got a few more minutes.
Yeah. I'm blaming those last comments on you, Pam. You always get, whatever, my best stuff, whatever I'm thinking, somehow your manner, whatever, always gets me to say things. I'd probably say it to Pam, but I shouldn't probably say that in public.
No, it's good stuff. It's great. Right. People are, nope, just lots of thank yous. Very encouraging and informative.
Okay.
Rave reviews. Well, I would just like to thank everyone for joining us today. The webinar slides will be sent out via email. We'll also post them on the project webpage along with the webinar recording. Please feel free to check out our project webpage for all of the resources and prior webinars. Steve, you're just getting a lot more thank yous and rave reviews. And thank you, Stephen, for being with us today. We're very happy to have you with us, and always appreciate the information and expertise that you can provide.
Well, thanks, Pam, and thanks for having me on here, and really appreciate the opportunity. It's been great. Thank you.
Of course. Thank you, everybody. Have a wonderful rest of your day. Be well and stay safe, and we'll see you soon. Bye, everybody. Thank you. Thanks, Steve.
Bye.